So our next speaker is Matthew Nicholls. He's a lecturer at Reading, and he's done work on Galen, but he also has a strong interest in architecture and social spaces, and he has done a lot of work with 3D models of architecture and social places. And he's going to talk to us today about ancient libraries, and so we're very grateful to him for speaking to us.
I'm looking at imperial era public libraries in Rome, mostly. I'll start a little bit before that, but I'm most at home in the first few centuries AD. Libraries built by Roman emperors in Rome and in the cities of the Eastern Roman provinces. And to do this, I tend to combine archaeological evidence with epigraphic material and literary texts such as the Galen that Francesca mentioned that I've worked on, trying to build up a picture of public library function in the Roman Empire, but also what these libraries signify and how they connect to wider landscapes of learning and of what we might call literacy. So I think in terms of cultural dissemination of text and readings of texts and the presence of literary culture in towns, hopefully this paper will connect quite well to what you've heard before. Were these libraries public libraries? In what sense were they public? The traditional view is not very, really. Pessimistic and narrowly cast views on literacy rates, which you've already heard about this morning, suggest that maybe there couldn't have been mass usership for these spaces. There are plenty of anecdotes about authors using these libraries, and I will show you some of them later, but there's not a great deal to connect them to a genuinely mass audience, still less to any substantive idea of popular education or cultural attainment after the manner of great philanthropic public library foundations in the 19th and 20th centuries, which I think still colours a bit our understanding of what a public library looks like and what it does. So there's a conventional line of argument that tends to observe that public libraries are mentioned by ancient authors, but not a lot, and therefore must have had a relatively small set of readers, were concerned really with communication within a fairly restricted elite, made little net contribution to the overall history of the production and transmission of classical literature. And there follows an agreement among some scholars of the subject that libraries in the Roman world had little effect on reading and writing. What survives from classical antiquity, whether in the chain of transmission from manuscript to manuscript, or in the fragments of ancient books that turn up directly in the papyrus record, doesn't seem to owe much, if anything, to the selection and preservation processes of big institutional libraries. There's a but coming. But I'm not sure how far I agree with that fairly narrowly defined and quite pessimistic model. Ancient sources do, after all, seem to see some sort of public quality or function in these libraries. The verb publicare and its cognates are used widely of Augustan library foundations, public libraries under Rome's first emperor, on the handout at one and on the screen. And more widely, more broadly, in ancient discussion of the identity and function of institutional libraries, people say things like the libraries at Pergamum were there for communem delectationem, some sort of public or shared enjoyment, that whole cities are lifted up to the possibility of learning through the presence of libraries. So there's a strand of ancient thought that seems to recognize at least some kind of nominally public identity or function for these spaces. And coupled to new directions in the study of ancient literature that you've already heard about this morning, literacy or literacies, into which this present gathering fits, I think we can maybe have another look at these libraries and see whether we can find different ways of reading and understanding them that get us out of the world of very narrow elites and consider their more public aspect. So we do this in the context of an understanding of modes of literacy that are rather more broadly conceived now. William Johnson and Holt Parker's Ancient Literacies, for example, the plural of its title, obviously building on challenging Harris's Ancient Literacy. And the essays in that volume and others like it, as you will know, complicate the categories of literacy that we might consider. So no longer just a sort of binary can you read or not division, or even the ladder that you were hearing about, how far up the ladder you can climb, but a complicated picture considering interactions with non-literary texts, the intersection and independence of traditionally opposed categories like orality and literacy, and you heard about Wiseman's book this morning, recitation and private reading, non-elite literacy such as that required for banking, commerce, and participation in civic government, democratic institutions like name literacy and list literacy, the materiality of text, realia, what do we do with the physicality of books and book materials, how does that condition responses to literacy and texts, How do authors respond to the materiality of the book in the library, connected to ideas of longevity and preservation, literary immortality, the commercial landscape of book copiers and sellers, and so on and so on. So intersections and interactions between various forms of literacy, and linked to those, the questions of cultural literacy and power relations that Francesca talked about. So if we look at Roman public libraries again, with some of these broader questions in mind, can we see some sort of public function for them that resonates with what ancient authors seem to be wanting to tell us? This gathering has an aim of casting lights on kinds and functions of literacy in the ancient Mediterranean. So is there a space in that world for big, physically large institutional libraries and formal architectural settings in the middle of town, which is what I'm talking about? How did these libraries interact with the literary world, affect processes of reading and writing and collecting and organizing access to books and texts? We're going to see that we find stories about scholars and meeting and reading in libraries. We find plenty also about how getting your work accepted for inclusion in a library, or conversely having it banned from a library, affects patterns of canon formation and authorial ambition in the Roman world. I don't really have time to talk about that today, but that's another strand in which the power of the book collection to shape what literature is a theme that is worth looking at and thinking about. And then there's a question related, but I think another question, about the meaning and identity of these libraries as monuments, as buildings, as landmarks within towns. Roman cities have these highly symbolically charged, ideologically freighted architectural landscapes full of conspicuous public buildings of every sort. And in that landscape, the construction of an investment in libraries as a category of monument makes a series of statements about what donors are interested in, what the cities that accept and house these libraries are interested in. This is the wider landscape of learning that I refer to in my title. So erecting a library with a conspicuous facade and a public program of statuary and inscriptions, like they all seem to have, signals a public attachment to literary culture and learning on the part of the donor, and a claim to a place in the interconnected intellectual and literary networks of the Roman Empire on the part of the towns that approve and host these libraries. And when we get to the Roman provinces a bit later, we'll see that libraries in the provinces often consciously evoke libraries in Rome, include both Roman and local elements of decoration and design. They act as symbols then of the joint identities of the donor and the recipient, urban Roman provincial community. And combining these two aspects, so public monument on the one hand and place for actual interaction with text on the other hand, we can look at how the architectural design of library buildings seems to have envisaged large numbers of visitors and interactions between people, and at the end, how they incorporate or are sometimes co-located with specialist auditorium facilities, suggesting, again, a close coexistence between different modes of literacy and orality, a place where libraries for the reading and writing of text and auditorium spaces for the performance of text coexist, often physically coexist in the Roman world. Which helps us to position libraries in an urban literary landscape and try and take some account of their function and their public identity or public function within the towns. So as I say, I shall talk mostly about Roman imperial libraries, where I think the evidence is best and I'm most at home. But there is a historical backdrop to this, as you were hearing in the previous paper. We could look back to the Hellenistic era and then beyond that back to the classical era, where there were stories about book collections often associated with tyrannical power. So Pisistratus and Polycrates, for example, Greek tyrants are both book collectors, library founders in some sense. But it's the Hellenistic world where big royal institutional libraries first come really to our prominent attention. The Ptolemies at Alexandria, where the culture of literary critical scholarship that you heard about develops apace. With Callimachus and others. And here at Pergamum, a space known to us archaeologically, which we might hesitantly and certainly not uncontroversially identify as the library, that colonnade, that's the edge of a big piazza with a temple to Athena in the middle of it. And the rooms down the northern flank of that colonnade are sometimes identified as a library hall and a suite of ancillary spaces with a colonnade for strolling and reading under shelter. The magnificent but totally speculative reconstruction of a nice Doric bookcase on the right is just a piece of eye candy, really. I mean, the library had the space which we commonly identify as a library, there or thereabouts were found busts of Homer and Herodotus. So that's where the attractive bust on top of the bookcase comes from. So take with a pinch of salt, but it's a picture of how these things might have appeared and been displayed. So some architectural magnificence, location in a formal public complex with a religious element to it, architectural grandeur, colonnades, formally appointed rectangular spaces, some architectural and architectonic decoration, some sculptural decoration, an elegant, royal, magnificent space. As the Roman Empire expanded into this Hellenistic Greek world, aristocratic Romans at the heads of their armies encountered these Greek libraries, liked them, pinched them, and took them back to Rome. And there are many examples one could cite. So Aemilius Paulus, for example, after the defeat of Perseus at the Battle of Pydna in 168 at the end of the Third Macedonian War, takes Perseus's library, ships it back to Rome, and he and his sons use that to form the core of a private salon, a literary community at Rome. Sulla might have got Aristotle's book collection or the tattered remnants of it when he conquered Athens, and those might have come back to Rome. I've said in an article on Galen that it's possible you can trace the presence of Aristotle's books or the catalogue of Aristotle's books as late as the 2nd century AD in Rome. Lucullus, whose booty from the Pontic Wars included the books or the libraries captured from kings in the East, and there are books from Mithridates and books from the sack of Carthage. Lucullus is worth dwelling on a bit. Here is what Plutarch says about this one particular case of a very rich Roman politician general using the booty of war to stimulate a sort of literary court at Rome in his own private library. Here is Cicero talking about Lucullus' library and his hospitality, the welcome he affords to scholars, including visiting Greeks. It's on the handout if you want to read all of it, but you can see that what Lucullus is doing here is creating a sort of private museum, a mini Alexandria in Rome, using his captured resources of Greek books and making his house, therefore his villa library, a sort of prytaneion, like an embassy for visiting Greeks. So it's a political, literary, cultural gesture of conquest and welcome and Romanness and Greekness. It's quite a complicated affair. This is Republican book collection, right? This is before the Roman emperors, where these libraries become the private possessions and private resources of leading aristocrats. But in their quasi-public presentation of those books to whole hosts of visiting Greeks and to people who might come to use the library even when Lucullus is not at home, it's pointing the way forwards, the way in which these book collections might be used to stimulate literary activity later on when the libraries become truly public. For now, though, in the Republic, library spaces look maybe like this. This is the villa of the papyri at Herculaneum, or rather, bottom left, that's the villa of John Paul Getty at Malibu, which he copied the Herculaneum villa and reproduced it there. The books are indicated on that map up there. I don't have my laser pointer, but there is no huge great book room. There are colonnades and gardens and peristyles and walkways. The books over on the right-hand side of the map there, the plan, there's a little room with icons in it. That's the book room of the villa. So a large walk-in cupboard, really, not a huge book space. The books to be taken out and enjoyed in the private grounds of the villa. And you can see them also scattered through the villa in a pattern that suggests to some people they were being hastily removed when the eruption happened that buried the villa to get them to safety, but might also suggest a pattern of use, of strolling, of reading in different rooms, of going out to the garden with a scroll if the sun was shining. So this is a private villa. Its disposition maybe recalls what Plutarch says about Lucullus' villa, about walking about in the cloisters with the scholars in his leisure hours. This is the idealized Roman literary aristocrat at home. The books, the 18th century excavators who pillaged this villa rather than excavated it, I think, tell us tantalizing stories about bits of furniture and maybe even little metal shelf labels and so on, all gone now. We have no idea of the collocation of these books within the library space. But there in that lost relief on Neumagen, we see maybe a picture of big scroll stacked edge on a shelf. So perhaps a storeroom, something like that, with the books taken out and shared around the villa. So this is literary life in the late Republic at Rome. This villa possibly owned by Julius Caesar's father-in-law, so pointing the way forward to the emergence of the Principate, the emperors, after the civil war attendant on the death of Caesar. And after the upheavals of that civil war, when the Republic ends and Augustus emerges as the first emperor in, let's say, 31 BC, several of these Republican private book collections probably ended up in his hands by confiscation or bequest, and he needed to do something with them, and he founded public libraries. So the first public library in Rome is 39 BC, it's Asinius Pollio's, but pretty quickly Augustus follows on with his own library foundations in the Porticus Octavii in 29 BC and up on the Palatine a couple of years later. He takes over Pollio's library in some sense. So Rome goes from zero public libraries to three within about 15 years. Augustus probably does this because he has a lot of books at his disposal. He has a lot of everything, villas, statues, slaves, money, enemies. And he wants to deploy the former to appease the latter and to engender the culture of bread and circuses that justifies his one-man rule to the people of Rome. The libraries at the Porticus Octavii are part of a piece of urban benefaction that really reshapes this whole part of town. So that's the portico there. The libraries are somewhere at the back of that, probably. Next to that is this huge Augustan theatre of Marcellus. These are Augustan temples, either new or rebuilt. These ones are all rebuilt as well. That paved square is relayed. Those porticos are new or rebuilt. That's a new theatre there. So this whole quarter, with its theatres, porticos, temples, libraries, public piazzas, it's a piece of urban regeneration or rebuilding under Augustus in which libraries are part of a magnificent urban display. And this sets a pattern. And at the same time, his son-in-law and right-hand man Agrippa is writing speeches about how it's necessary to display all statues and paintings publicly. So the regime is issuing little manifesto pamphlets about putting art on public view. And the libraries, I think, are part of that. So the cultural and literary life of Rome are expanding now rapidly beyond the confines of a few elite houses and starting to become landmarks in the city. Augustus, as in every area, sets a pattern which later emperors follow. So in blue is a timeline of imperial library foundations at Rome. Augustus is the big spike on the left-hand side. And you see every few decades, another emperor or two adds another library or two at Rome. And in the back, in gray, are provincial library foundations by private donors. And you see that they start to pick up and imitate imperial library donation in their towns. And then in the start of the second century AD, there's this enormous spike, really in the cities of the Greek East, where either those prosperous, increasingly self-confident Greek cities in the grip of what we call the second sophistic movement of intellectual renaissance are imitating the emperors at Rome, seeing that libraries are fashionable and they want to be fashionable and please the emperor, and therefore they imitate those imperial library foundations, or emperors in Rome see a great wave of interest in intellectual public culture in the Greek East and found libraries in response to that, or both. So the early second century is an interesting peak in the timeline. How did Roman authors and readers interact with these libraries? There are a number of passages that tell us a bit about it. Here is Ovid, exiled from Rome, mournfully imagining a tour around Rome by one of his books. This is on your handout. And the book visits all three of these Augustan public libraries in turn and gets turned away from them. So we could be talking here about censorship and control, which is an interesting strand here. But just for now, let's note that Ovid describes this library as a place where whatever men of old or more recent times have conceived in their learned breasts lie open to be inspected by readers. So Ovid is envisaging old literature shelved alongside new literature, and he's envisaging readers there. It somehow lies open, that it's accessible to readers. It's not just a royal sort of Wunderkammer of precious scrolls that's locked away. It's somehow open, and the books that are there for reading. I've done a bit on Galen. I needn't dwell too much on Galen because I've published on him and there's a few bits on the handout. But Galen, in his recently rediscovered Perialopias on Consolation from Greece, gives us this mine of information now, a couple of centuries after Ovid, about how these libraries are still being used for literary endeavor. He gives us a partial content list of the Palatine Library in particular, which is full of peripatetic science. he makes it very clear that he read in this library, he took extensive notes, he delighted in finding mistakes in the catalogue, he made his own fair copies. So he's reading voluminously there, but also he is somehow writing up there, he or his slave scribes. There is space there for writing and producing copies. I might come back to that. Elsewhere is a JRS article on the handout. I've talked about the catalogue that he says he's using there, and I've tried to trace that back to a catalogue of Aristotle's library books, which we may or may not believe. But I think we can say, if we read Galen and tot up all the stuff that he says he's seen in the Palatine Library, there are book collections in there that are still identifiable as collections. The individual manuscripts are several centuries old by AD 192. He says at some length how they're precious for their accuracy and reliability, for which we also might read age, right? They go as far back in the chain of transmission as it's possible to get. He sees this as a precious scholarly resource. And then it burns down, which is the subject of his letter in 192. But also he gives us this picture of a landscape of learning. So he portrays himself moving busily between spaces on the map that I've arrowed here. The Palatine Libraries, the library in the Temple of Peace, the Templum Parcus. Oh, I've given you in English and Latin there, sorry. Temple of Peace or Templum Parcus. He tells us that somewhere where you see in green, he had a private storeroom in a warehouse where he just rented a lockup so that all his working notebooks and pens and equipment and medical supplies he could leave there so that they were close by when he was doing his library work. It's like you want to get a locker in the library at the start of the day where you can put your stuff and then you have a little base. He talks also about the booksellers on the streets labeled red and blue at the top of the map. And I've suggested that those booksellers are there because the customers are there, and the customers are there because the libraries are there. So there's a sort of center of gravity or momentum built up by the libraries that turn this landscape, which is, of course, a political and symbolic and religious and commercial landscape, also into a learned landscape, the very heart of Rome. His younger contemporary, Aulus Gellius, master of Lemmatized literature, is also reading in these libraries. I've given you some more passages on the handout. Here's just one of them. So here he is. He browses in libraries. In this one, he's having a sort of discussion session, a seminar or a chat with a group in the library. So some of these people are friends. So his great hero, Sulpicius Apollinaris, but also some others who are friends of his or mine. So a mixed group. They don't all know each other. Are sitting in this library, and a book is brought to them, which has a name on that they don't recognize, which is interesting. So the books are brought to them. There's maybe a page service. You order your book and it's brought to you. But this is the wrong book, or a book they haven't ordered, or they don't know what it is, which is interesting. And a young man, not unacquainted with letters, pipes up and gives his opinion. Not someone Gellius knows. So mixed groups, mixed in age, mixed in background maybe, mixed in ability, and having a nice chat about obscure Cato's in one of Rome's libraries. So we might be cautious of taking these stories absolutely at face value, but they do evoke and construct a world of high-status reading and discussion that includes libraries. Libraries are one setting among several in Gellius's beaumont for what Johnson sees as features of a reading culture of that time. Groups of people at reading events, participants moving between conversation and reading, talking about abstruse learned topics and points of grammar, competing with one another in displays of erudition. Maybe that link between paideia and power that Francesca was talking about, and ways of constructing a version of yourself in your conversation, and still more so when you go and write it up afterwards, as Gellius does, creating an idealized vision of literary interactions, some of which happen in library spaces. So a particular version of literacy here, maybe ideological, Romanized Romanness through literacy, constructed in Gellius's texts, but public libraries are one setting for this. So Galen, Gellius, Ovid, we could add others, talk about these libraries as spaces for reading and discussion. So far, we've not got very far beyond these literary elites that I said at the start characterize a lot of understanding of these libraries, but we are at least now populating them with people who are reading texts and talking about texts. Galen's description of the bookish landscape of Rome and Gellius's evocation of spaces for browsing and sitting are moving us towards thinking about the physicality of these buildings. Where are they? What do they look like? Here they are. This is a bit gratuitous, but since you heard I have an interest in 3D modeling, this is ancient Rome, and we're going to have a look at where the libraries were. This is Rome as it appeared maybe in the early 4th century AD. So libraries that we know about at or before that date are going to flash across the screen. So there's the
Pollio's library somewhere down there in what was the Atrium Libertatis, the Palatine libraries, the Porticus Octavii libraries over behind that theatre, the Domus Tiberianum, where we've just met Gellius sitting and chatting with a mixed group. Library of the Temple of the Deified Augustus, don't know much about that one. Templum Parcus Library, very, very significant centre of the learned arts, as Galen calls it. Possible bathhouse libraries, no time to talk about them, but they might exist. Trajan's libraries, we're going to meet in a moment. Capitoline Library, all we know about that, it was struck by lightning in the 3rd century. Maybe another bathhouse library there, and a library in the Pantheon mentioned in one catalogue of ancient artworks. So there's a lot of them. These are just the ones we know about. If you look at the Constantinian regionary catalogues of Rome, there are 28 libraries mentioned in those. So this is a city with actually a rather large provision of libraries. If we look to the empire as a whole, chiefly the Greek east of the empire, we see a number of them founded in the cities of the east as well. So within these cities, what do these libraries look like? Where were they? Can we move towards understanding a wider sort of significance for these buildings and spaces? Public manifestations of values invested in literature by people like Galen and Gellius, but now expressed architecturally to a wide public audience. These are, after all, expensive buildings, and they're always put on really expensive city centre land. This is Timgad in Algeria. These are the ruins of the library. You see where it is on the map. It's one block away from the Forum, right in the middle of town. It occupies a whole city block. This is a building that's trying to address a big public audience. You can see there it has a nice open colonnade, a square, a public mini piazza opening off the street, inviting you to come and sit and stroll. And then the main book room is rather magnificently appointed. So structures like that choose city centre land. They make a big public address. They're not hiding away. They're not private members' clubs down a back street. They are public monuments. The Library of Celsus at Ephesus, which may be familiar to many of you, with its wonderful facade. Also, you can see right in the middle of town, at the busiest, most central street corner in the whole of Ephesus, addressing that streetscape with an ebullient Baroque facade of projecting and recessing architectural aedicules and inscriptions and gilded bronze statues and the works. It's a billboard, really, behind which there is a library. Going into the libraries, as we've just done, what can we say about their architectural function and appearance? We don't know much about ones in Rome early on. The marble plan of Rome, there it is, preserves the footprint of what we think are the Palatine libraries of Augustus, those double apsidal chambers. The archaeology suggests that early on, this was a single chamber. You see it ringed there in the Jacopi Tadone plan, opening onto a porticoed courtyard that later on in a rebuild under the Flavians was doubled up. So even in its first phase, though, it's a substantial public building, big area of central floor span, a colonnade around the walls, an apse at the back for a large statue. So a monumental public space, a monument, not just a cupboard, as we saw in the Villa of the Papyri, a cupboard full of books. We know about meetings of the Senate being held in these libraries. I've given you that on the handout at 4.1 on page 4. So they're big enough to accommodate several hundred Roman senators. The complex is adjacent to Augustus's palace, so it's a convenient spot for him to have the Senate meet when he's not feeling very well. That seems to be its use. So these are the first imperial public library spaces in Rome. They seem, as far as we can tell, to set a pattern architecturally. Again, looking at the evidence of the fragmentary marble plan of Rome, the arrowed space there in the Templum Parcus is probably the library room. So a large space, again, within a formal imperial public complex. We can do a bit better if we look at the libraries of Trajan's Forum, which is a few years later again. So Augustus's library is the 20s BC, the Templum Parcus, the 70s AD, Trajan's Forum, the 110s, 120s AD. So every few generations, emperors upgrade and expand Rome's library space. And the twin library buildings of Trajan's Forum, which we'll look at now, allow us to examine the structure and workings of an imperial library and also are widely imitated in the provinces. I think it's the Trajanic buildings we're about to look at that set a pattern that later provincial donors emulate. So we're now flying from the Templum Park, as we started above the library, down the sequence of big imperial forum spaces in central Rome, which you can see line up with each other and talk to each other architecturally. That's Augustus's. They were just flying over there. Then we get to Trajan's Library, which is the biggest of them all, Trajan's Forum, rather, this huge piazza with a transverse basilica ulpia across the back of it. And then as we skim over the roof of the basilica, we'll find ourselves looking down into a little courtyard in which stands Trajan's Column. And flanking Trajan's Column are those two library buildings. So this is in a really, really prominent, prestigious imperial commemorative space. Trajan is buried at the bottom of that column, indeed. It's a funeral complex. So this is, you can't get more prestigious, more expensive than this. The integration of libraries into this complex therefore says something about Trajan's conception and presentation of his reign and the Roman character to the ages. The buildings we commonly identify as the libraries that we know about from literary sources, passages on the handout, are those twin halls that were cleared by Mussolini, or the Western one was, in the 30s. And its salient architectural features, especially the niches in the wall here that are arrowed, there it is also on the marble plan. So these twin chambers with niches in the walls, a colonnade around the inside, now rather gloomily buried under Mussolini's Via dei Fori Imperiali. So that's what it looks like now. But there's still enough in there in terms of its decoration and materials that we can reconstruct it fairly confidently to look something like this. So now flying into that space, we get an impression of one of the best understood imperial libraries that we'll see sets a pattern for provincial ones. A large rectangular hall, internal colonnade, wall niches probably holding bookcases, architectural magnificence. Look at the floor, hold the floor in your mind, gray granite with yellow giallo antico patterns around it, pavanazzetto and granite elsewhere in the building as well. Really beautiful space, but a controlled space under the gaze probably of a large statue of the Emperor Trajan. Architectonic, decorative and sculptural elements used to impress the visitor, and probably lots of visitors, because there's a big open floor span in here. As I calculated, about 6% of the volume of this building is given over to housing books. That's a really inefficient library if you think libraries are just for housing books. The British Library, for example, dedicates about 25% of its floor area to permanent pure book storage, they tell me. So Trajan's Library is either really badly built or is trying to do something else. I suspect it's the latter. It's trying to be a space which has a large central volume that lots of people can meet in, look at the artwork, sit, read, visit and debate. Wiseman's oral presentations of literature, perhaps. And there are security features too. We flew in through a bronze grill. The cupboards and the walls just put a bit of distance between a mass visiting public and the actual precious books, which makes us wonder whether these libraries were lending libraries or not, and it's normally thought not. Here's a lovely piece of epigraphic evidence from Athens, the Library of Pantinos, again on a very, very busy street corner, addressing that street corner with colonnades and statues. And this stone that says, no book may be taken out because we have sworn it. The library will be open from the first to the sixth hour. So opening hours and a borrowing policy. Suggesting, I think, a wider usership, a usership that's beyond the people personally known to librarians. Otherwise, why do you have to inscribe the rules and talk about swearing oaths and so on? This seems to me to be a building with a public aspect. So we're seeing large decorated rooms, central public locations, monumental decoration, artworks, all of the libraries that survive that are known to us conform to some or all of those basic features. And they seem to me to address large audiences, audiences beyond those who simply read the books there. Of course, they are important, perhaps the most important category of users, but a wider population would walk past them, be impressed by them, maybe look at the inscriptions or the statues, and understand a message of cultural patronage and prestige. These libraries around the provinces of the empire seem to follow patterns architecturally modeled after Trajan's libraries at Rome, or in a typology that includes Trajan's library. So all of these have the niche cupboards, the large central floor area, space for statuary. Sagalassos may or may not be a library. We don't actually know whether it is, but the others are. And it's interesting, if Sagalassos is not a library, that libraries are in this continuum of large monumentalized commemorative public spaces that might be multifunction. the smallest corpus of library buildings that we see here. Now, all of these quite tightly clustered in time in the second century AD, are a good way of exploring how fashions in civic euergetism, the practice of building monumental architecture and donating it to your city, how fashion spread from the center, from imperial Rome, from exemplar emperors like Trajan and Hadrian, out to the provinces and back again in a sort of dialogue of using literature as one vehicle of expressing in the townscape identities and practices and tastes, and emperors as models of philanthropic taste. The decorative scheme of libraries like Celsus's library at Ephesus help instantiate this idea of Roman and local identities in a kind of propagandistically happy harmony. So Celsus is a local made good. He got to the top of the magisterial tree in Rome, became consul, came back to Asia Minor, and in his will dedicated this library. And the facade includes statues of himself several times, with his entire career in both Latin and Greek, to capture the widest possible range of actual literacies in the town, and members of his family. And then across the bottom deck, maybe rather preposterously to modernize, his intellectual virtues personified as gilded bronze statues, the Sophia, Arete, Ennoia, and Episteme of Celsus as female statues, announcing his intellectual virtues as patron, and maybe by implication, the town's intellectual qualities, now this monument was in it. Hedging his bets in the dedicatory inscription of the library, not only does he put this huge billboard to himself and his family into the streetscape at this busy street corner, but he makes provision for an endowment that will fund the gardening of his statues and a feast on his birthday every year. So trying to make this library part of the commemorative and active philanthropic landscape of the town, part of the world we know very well at Ephesus from other inscriptions of processions and events and festivals and feasts. And maybe this inscription from Dyrrachium is doing something similar. Here, Lucius Flavius Aemilius Tellurius Gaetulicus is dedicating a library and also putting on 12 pairs of gladiators at his own expense to celebrate the opening of the library. So maybe reaching out to the whole town and to people who wouldn't necessarily be very interested in reading the books, as well as those who would be. So trying to broaden the scope of these benefactions and make the libraries work for the patron as hard as they can as commemorative spaces. These buildings have these grand central rooms. But Galen, for example, is talking about writing a lot as well. Were there ancillary spaces, spaces that broadened the actual practical functionality of the library beyond this grand public-facing monumentalized space? Sometimes I think there were. Here at Timgad, you see the ground plan includes not only the main apsidal library chamber, but six smaller rooms, which we might envisage as, well, what? We don't know. Overflow stack storage, accommodation for librarian custodians, spaces for educational activities, and the graffiti in the courtyard outside suggests there was a sort of coming and going public quality to this space. Maybe scriptoria or rooms for mending books and copying books, possibly so. Speculation, but something is going on in those six separate chambers, and we see them in other library spaces or around other library buildings as well, back rooms, side rooms, smaller rooms alongside the main book space. As well as these extra spaces, libraries were associated sometimes with larger or more formally appointed spaces for public performative events like lectures, recitations, or disputations. So the lively world of the Greek second sophistic, the literary renaissance in second century AD, Greek east of the Roman Empire, which we know included endless speeches by civic orators and presentations and delegations and embassies and recitals and disputes and lectures. Maybe we envisage some of these happening in or near library buildings, again connecting different forms of literacy and performance. So here is an inscription from the library at Ephesus or from nearby, a later inscription saying the city has constructed a pavement in front of the auditorium and the library of Celsus from the will of Julia Potentilla. So presumably these spaces are near each other because there's a single pavement that is now in front of them. The auditorium, a Latin word rendered there into Greek, what's going on there in this auditorium space? Perhaps the sorts of performative events that I've been talking about, making the library and the
lecture space or listening space communicate with each other. So libraries, again, as part of a landscape of learning and activity within the town. And larger library complexes could include spaces for listening and talking within their design. So Galen, who you've heard me talk about already, talks about the library of the Templum Parcus here as the place that even before the fire was where all those who engaged in the learned arts used to gather together. And then later on in that same passage of On My Own Books, he says that he gave a performance, one of his bravura self-defensive medical performances in Catetitum Megalon Acusterion, in one of the large lecture halls in the Templum Parcus. He doesn't quite say it's in the Templum Parcus, but the context of the passage strongly implies it is. And he begins this dispute by bringing out armfuls of medical books and challenging his detractors to, you pick any passage and I will refute it. So he's somewhere near a huge collection of medical books that he can that dramatically bring in and put on the desk in this auditorium, which seems to me, again, to point to a connection between library space, book storage space, performance, and backing up oral performance with reference to written texts, using them as props to prove his learning. Where were these large Megalon Acusterion in the Templum Parcus? We don't know, but you remember that I arrowed one of the rooms in the back wall as a probable library, and it might be that the flanking spaces here were useful spaces for gathering large quantities of people to hear learned disputation. We know the Templum Parcus had this sort of proto-university function to it. Authors tell us that. If we look at the very similar ground plan of the Library of Hadrian at Athens, which we know a little bit better from excavation, all of those rooms at the north end, or the top end rather, of the Templum Parcus are under a massive road junction that Massolini built, so we can't really get to them very easily. But in Athens, we do understand it better, and there, those outer rooms at the top of the diagram have raked seating. They're purpose-built lecture spaces or disputation spaces, auditoria. And the library room is in the middle at the back there. So twin spaces flanking a central library room, architecturally a close conjunction between book space and speaking space. Here's a little fly through the colonnade. So over on the right-hand side there, you just see the start of the steps of the auditorium. And then the colonnade's full of art and gilding. There's the central book room in the middle of the colonnade. And the magnificence of the marbles and the gilded capitals and so on is based on Pausanias' account of this building, which calls it very beautifully adorned, very prestigious space. And to end, we might note that this Roman-style library built at Athens by Hadrian is possibly containing similar functions to a building that Hadrian built at Rome called the Athenaeum, so connections between Rome and Athens, and similar sorts of architecture linking books and performance. The Athenaeum is called a school for the liberal arts by Aurelius Victor, Ludus Ingenuarum Artium. Until recently, we didn't know much about it physically, but we do have various late authors who talk about it. I put the passages on the handout at 4.3. We know it had an assembly hall in it. Meetings with the Senate sometimes happened there. It had judicial functions sometimes. Sidonius talks about library rooms and subcellia and seating arranged somehow in cunea, in wedges. So ranked seats rising up a gradient, I suspect. So some sort of formal seating for lectures, disputes, recitals, and so on. So symmetrical foundations, Roman-style library at Athens, library and auditoria at Rome called the Athenaeum, suggesting the strong cultural flavour of Hadrian's reign, which we all know about. He's a Hellenophile and learned emperor. And this correspondence fits well with the overall picture I've been trying to trace out in this talk, the idea of public library provision in Rome and in the provinces, putting the emperor at the head of a tradition of philanthropic library provision in Rome, and doing that in the ferment of a public literary culture that includes all sorts of reading but also performative events in the Greek East. And as it happens, we now might have architectural traces of this complex, which might be a nice place to end. So Rome, as you might know, is very badly served by its underground railway. There are only two lines. So they've been, for years, trying to build a third line, Metro C. And the construction of Metro C is slightly hampered by the fact wherever you dig a hole in Rome, you find some artifact at the bottom of it that has to be documented and preserved. So here at the Piazza Venezia, they are trying to build a station for Metro C, And when they dug the hole for it, they found these impressive brick halls. You see in the map in the top right-hand corner there, a series of roughly identical brick and concrete halls set radially around the curving wall of a piazza, of which this is one. You see here the size of the hall with the lump in the middle is a bit of roof vault that's collapsed down into it when it collapsed in an earthquake, probably in the 9th century. So the suite of brick buildings can be dated by brick stamps to AD 123 to 125, so the reign of Hadrian. And each of these three halls was a large rectangular building with two opposed banks of seating. So seats rising up in the way, maybe the Sidonius describes, banks of seats. So buildings that are purpose-built for, what, Senate meetings, but also maybe discussions, lectures, and demonstrations. Concrete barrel vault above that's collapsed down. Much despoiled by later use as copper smithing workshops in the 6th and 7th centuries, and then burials in the 8th century AD, and then the roofs collapsed. So they're in a sorry state now. But the excavators have been able to reconstruct the interior fittings. This is my reconstruction of how that curved piazza might have looked, and the halls there are the ones on the left, to the left of that still controversial temple that may or may not be there. There is a piazza with these halls set radially around. And look where they are. They are right next to the library courtyard, where Trajan's Column is. The buildings either side of that, I still think are the libraries. Others disagree, but I'm pretty sure they are. So libraries and lecture halls in close conjunction with each other, all built around the same time, end of the reign of Trajan, start of the reign of Hadrian, exactly the moment when in the provinces, Celsus is building his library and library at Timgad, it was a bit later actually, library at Dyrrhachium. There's this great boom of library provision following, imitating, and maybe partly spurring this stuff that's going on in Rome. And if we look inside these spaces, enough little fragments of the decoration survive to show us, for example, floors of rectangular grey granite slabs with giallo antico borders. That is the floor I asked you to remember from the adjacent library spaces. So they are decorated to look identical. They're all part of a suite of buildings. They're visually connected to each other as well as physically connected to each other and contiguous with each other. So a complex of contemporary buildings in rich decorative adornment. Until we find an inscription somewhere in this complex that says this is the Athenaeum, the jury is out. But even if it's not the Athenaeum that we know of from the literary sources, it's an important Hadrianic complex of audience or debate halls in the attested location of major imperial libraries. So I think the firmest and most extensive evidence yet of major facilities for orality, debate, recitation, lectures in conjunction with library spaces laid out for the storage and consultation of written texts in the way that Gellius, for example, talks about. And this conjunction of expensive, prominent, magnificent spaces imitated in the cities of the provinces, marking a formal development of the wider architecture and landscape of urban learning that my title mentions, a landscape in which different sorts of building, housing different sorts of literary and scholarly activity, gave parts of the city of Rome and of provincial cities a complex, monumental, and learned flavor. Thank you.